Each of us, by our work here, contributes to a movement of love. May love hold and heal those who need to be held and healed. May love guide more and more people every day. We bless our chalice this morning, knowing that we are blessed to be in the business of growing love. May our work be held together. Bless the world.
Good morning. My name is Carol Stowell. I'm going to have the children stay right where they are because I might step on you. So when 30 years ago, I used to do children's birthday parties as Miss Princess Pickapocket. And I had that time my son was a toddler, and then my other kids were teenagers. So I loved this story because it was all about those different stages of life. And the story is, I'll love you forever. Once upon a time, there was a mother who had a little baby. And she would pick him up and she would rock him back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And she would sing this song. I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. Well, you know what happened to that baby? He grew. He grew and he grew and he grew until he was a two-year-old. And that two-year-old would run around the house, tear the books out of the bookshelf, and one day took his mother's watch and dropped it in the toilet. And that mother, she'd scream, oh, this kid is driving me crazy. But sometimes late at night, that mother would tiptoe up to his room, look up over the bed, and if that two-year-old was sound asleep, she would pick him up, and she would rock him back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, and she would sing. I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. Well, You know what happened to that two-year-old? He grew. He grew and he grew and he grew until he was 9 years old. And when she'd call him in for dinner, he wouldn't come in. And when he finally did, all he would eat was desserts. And when grandma would visit, he would say bad words. And that mother, she'd scream sometimes, oh, this nine-year-old, he's just driving me crazy. But sometimes late at night when that nine-year-old was sound asleep, she would tiptoe up into his room, and if he was sound asleep, she'd pick him up and she would rock him back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, and she'd sing that song. I'll love you for always, I'll like you forever, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. Well, that nine-year-old, he grew and he grew and he grew and he grew until he was a teenager. And that teenager would wear weird clothes, listen to weird music, and have his weird friends come over to the house. Oh, this teenager, he's driving me crazy. But sometimes late at night, she would tiptoe up to his room, and if that teenager was down to sleep, she would pick him up, and she would rock him back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, and she would sing that song really fast because she couldn't do it very long. I'll love you for always, I'll like you forever, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. Whoa! It is not easy to love a teenager. Well, that teenager, he grew and he grew and he grew and he moved out of the house and he moved across town. But sometimes that mother, she'd get in her car. She had a ladder up on the roof. And if the house was dark, she'd take that ladder, put it up next to the house. She'd climb up that ladder, look in the window. And if everybody was sound asleep, she'd tiptoe across the floor, reach out, and she'd pick her grown son up. And she'd, I'll love you for always. I'll like you forever. As long as I'm living, my baby, you'll be. Well, a long, long, long time passed, and one day that mother, she grew very old, and she grew very sick, and she called that grown son on the phone. She said, would you come over and see me, because I'm very old, and I'm very sick. So that grown son, he got in his car and he drove over. And she looked up at him one more time and she said, I'll love you. I'll love you. I'll love you. But she was too old and she was too sick. And so that grown son, he reached down. And he picked his mother up, and he rocked her back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, and he sang to her, I'll love you for always, I'll like you forever, as long as I'm living, my mommy you'll be. And that grown son, he got in his car, and He drove home, and he walked in the door, and he went up to the bedroom of his little baby boy. And he reached down to that little boy who was sound asleep. I'll love you for always, I'll like you forever, as long as I'm living. My baby, you'll be. And that's the story of I'll Love You Forever.
They Are Still With Us by Kathleen McTeague. In the struggles we choose for ourselves, in the ways we move forward in our lives and bring our world forward with us, it is right to remember the names of those who give us strength in this choice of living. Those who lived before us, who struggled for justice and suffered injustice before us, have not melted into the dust and have not disappeared. They are still with us. The lives they lived hold us steady. Their words remind us and call us back to ourselves. Their courage and love evoke our own. We, the living, carry them with us. We are their voices, their hands, and their hearts. We take them with us and with them choose the deeper path of living.
Good morning. Famous last words. I've been thinking about that phrase lately. I celebrated an anniversary this week on August 31st, 2021, around 9:15 p.m. at York Hospital. I nearly spoke my literal last words. And as somebody who spent most of their professional life trying to find just the right words, it didn't go well. I wouldn't have wanted what I said in that moment to be my famous last words, but I'll come back to that. When my dad got sick in the week before he died, he spent a few days in the hospital as his care team tried to figure out a way to keep the fluid from building up in his lungs. He had an oxygen mask on for much of the time to help him breathe. One day, a Saturday afternoon, while we were all with him, and he was still strong enough and alert enough, he took the mask off and he talked. Now, my dad was not what I would call a talkative man. He could be funny and gregarious in social situations, or, boy, if he got together with his brothers, forget about it. But with me and my brothers, he generally didn't have a lot to say. That changed as he slipped into old age, but I don't remember a lot of deep conversations with him. When he took that oxygen mask off, though, he had some things he wanted to say. He wanted us to hear. He knew the end was coming. I wish I had written some of it down. The memory of that day has been in my head as I started thinking about last words. But I needed a few other ideas, so off to Google. Keyword search, famous last words. W.C. Fields supposedly said, "God damn the whole friggin' world and everyone in it but you, Carlotta." Carlotta was his mistress. So I'm not sure I'll keep that on my list of possible last words. Margaret Sanger, the founder of Planned Parenthood, said, "A party, let's have a party." While I like the idea of having a party for me after I'm gone, I don't want to use my last words to extend the invitation. There are a couple of instances of poets using their final words to be, well, poetic. Rainer Maria Wilke, a German poet, as he lay dying of leukemia, managed this final thought: "I don't want the doctor's death. I want to have my own freedom." Emily Dickinson said simply, "I must go in, for the fog is rising." Harriet Tubman, as most of you probably know, was an abolitionist, a key figure on the Underground Railroad. And after the Civil War, she was fiercely involved in women's suffrage. Her final words were, "Give my love to the churches. Tell the women to stand firm. I go to prepare a place for you." Isaac Newton, one of the giants of science, said, "I seem to have been only like a boy playing on the seashore and diverting myself now and then in finding a smoother pebble or a prettier shell than the ordinary, whilst the great ocean of truth lay all undiscovered before me." He's being humble. Da Vinci went a little further. "I have offended God and mankind because my work did not reach the quality it should have." Da Vinci said that. Rest easy, Leonardo. I think you did a pretty good job. The actor Michael Landon was surrounded by his family, and one of his sons gently told him he could move on. And Michael Landon said, "You're right. It's time. I love you all. George Harrison, the wise Beatle, had this final message relayed by his wife Olivia after his passing. Everything else can wait, but the search for God cannot wait, and love one another. The more I thought about this, the more I came to realize that the best last words represent a kind of message, particularly from people who have lived lives of, in one way or another, of significance. It's a way for people who know they are at the end to pass along that one most important lesson they learned on their life journey. Harriet Tubman said, "Stand firm for justice, for peace, for equality." Michael Landon said, "I love you all." George Harrison said, "Keep searching for God, for wisdom, for love." My dad said, "Take care of each other." When I think about my own life and my journey, I think about mistakes, lots of mistakes. But I've done a few good things too, like paying for a complete stranger's groceries at Giant one day, or working at a place that helped children with special needs, telling their stories, making a difference in their lives, or loving my dogs right up to the end. I look around the sanctuary today and I see so many faces, so many people filled with kindness and caring. It's one of the many reasons I've stayed at this place for 20 years. So as we think about last words, I'll point back to the reading and what Kathleen McTeague said. "Those of us who lived before us," she said, "have not melted into the dust and have not disappeared. They are with us still. The lives they lived hold us steady. Their courage and love evoke our own. We take them with us, and with them choose the deeper path of living." And I would add, we take their words with us too. Stand firm. I love you all. Keep searching. Take care of each other. That's a pretty good list of last words. I just hope I can remember them when the time comes. Because in the hospital that night 2 years ago, I messed it up. Here's what happened. I walked into the emergency department at York Hospital, complaining of heaviness in my chest. They took me back right away, hooked me up to an EKG, and found I had already had a heart attack. The doctor who came out with the little paper that has the lines on it pointed to one part of the line, said, "This is concerning." Yeah, it was concerning. They wheeled me back to a room where Sean and I waited for a heart catheterization team to arrive. While we waited, medical people came in and out, hooking me up to monitors and taking tests. And while I was waiting, I sent a few work messages just to let them know, you know, the kind, "I had a heart attack, I won't be in tomorrow." After the last of those messages, I started to feel dizzy, and I handed my phone to Sean, and I said, "Oh, shit." And then I blacked out. I found out later I had gone into cardiac arrest that lasted about 45 seconds, my cardiologist told me. I woke up, and they were still giving me chest compressions after they had used the paddles on me to restart my heart. 2 years later, heart still beating, filled with gratitude, and maybe a little more wisdom about last words. But who knows, as I continue on my journey, I might change my mind about what I might say. But I'm sure of this, if you're in a situation where you want to make a lasting impression on your family and friends that might be gathered around you, do not, under any situation, use that moment to say, "Oh, shit." Blessed be.
I can't say.
We are grateful to mark time with seasons, to celebrate birthdays and anniversaries, or to gather as family to remember our loved ones. In all these seasons, may we give thanks for the birth of life, ever mindful of the fragile nature of existence. May we live fully in each moment. From summer to fall and winter to spring, we gather in mystery and in the bonds of beloved community. May we radiate love both within and beyond these walls, this day and all the days to come, caring for those we love and for those we have yet to meet.